What's going on, PBC? Victor Malbarossa here, coming to you from Dorm 3 Side Room. I hope you're doing awesome. I hope you're staying healthy, staying sane in this crazy time. With all these changes and adjustments we've been making, there's one thing that's not gonna change. We're still gonna get to hear from our seniors. It's gonna look a little bit different, much like how our staff have been doing their devotional thoughts, which, by the way, thank you guys so much for helping us feel loved and encouraged in this crazy, crazy time. Thank you. I'm gonna get right into it. Would you help me and turn with me to Jeremiah 29, verse 1? Not verse 11, we'll get to verse 11 soon, but turn to verse 1 first. So I'm reading from the CSB. I'll wait for you to get there. All right, verse 1. This is the text of the letter that the prophet Jeremiah sent from Jerusalem to the remaining exiled elders, the priests, the prophets, and all the people Nebuchadnezzar had deported from Jerusalem to Babylon. This was after King Jeconiah, who was also King Jehoiakim in most narratives, the queen mother, the court officials, the officials of Judah and Jerusalem, the craftsmen, the metalsmiths, thousands of people get deported and left Jerusalem. He sent a letter through diplomatic mail through his inside guys. He used the inside people. He was smart to get his letter through the diplomatic mail to get it to the exiles over in Babylon. And this is what it says. Verse 4. This is what the Lord of armies, the God of Israel, says to all the exiles I deported from Jerusalem to Babylon. Verse 5. Build houses and live in them. Plant gardens and eat their produce. Find wives for yourselves and have sons and daughters. Some of you are like, that's for me. I receive. Chill, bro. She's coming. Context. Okay? Context. Multiply there. Don't decrease. And verse 7. We'll focus on this. Pursue the well-being of the city I've deported you to. Pray to the Lord on its behalf. For when it thrives, you thrive. For when it thrives, you thrive. Just gonna give a little bit of background. You got the North and the South Kingdom. The North Kingdom has just been demolished by the Assyrians in 722. And the South guys are like, serves them right. We're going to be just fine because we have the temple. We got the big T temple. And God sends these prophets to say otherwise and says, no, you're not going to be fine. God is raising up this guy. His name is Nebuchadnezzar. And he's going to take y'all out if you guys don't get y'all act together. Unfortunately, they don't get their act together. And Babylon finds their way to Judah and makes their king Jehoiakim their slave, their master, their puppet, their vassal. Jehoiakim messes up. He gets booted out of the game. His brother gets instated as the new king, but only 3 months until Babylon comes back and takes all of these people out of Jerusalem, thousands of people. 2 Kings 24 says only the poor people were left in Jerusalem. And these people are taken out of their normal lives, out of their temple system, out of their comfort zone. Their lives are just ripped from them so that they can serve this king, Nebuchadnezzar, in this foreign land with these foreign gods surrounding them. Their lives are ripped away from them. And kind of sounds like what we're going through. And Jeremiah writes, just before Jerusalem is burned down, just demolished by the Babylonians, and he's not like, you know, serves you right, you deserve all of this, I told you so. No, he's very kind, he's pastoral, and he gives a few tips, not just encouragements, but also a few tips on how they can survive or thrive in this season. And that's why he's saying build houses, plant gardens, find wives, make children, is because he wants them to make the most out of their time there in Babylon and not expecting things to go back to the way that they used to when they were comfortable in Jerusalem. I was kind of guilty of this when this whole chaos started happening. And I take what's called depression naps, where when I don't want to feel anything, when I don't want to, you know, have any responsibilities, I just don't set a timer, plop on my bed and sleep. Because when I sleep, I don't feel anything, I don't know anything, I have no responsibilities. And that's a bad reason to take a nap. There's better reasons to take naps. But we can ourselves get into a spiritual nap where we just don't want to face any of this. We just kind of want to sleep in our spirit and wake up when everything is back to the way that it used to be. And Jeremiah is helping us to understand that things happen. God causes things to happen. I'm not suggesting that God willed COVID-19, but God uses it. And he uses it to test us and to mold us and to shape us into who he wants us to be. And it says here in verse 7, he actually uses three times a very important Hebrew word. Pursue the shalom of the city, for when it shalom, you shalom. You probably heard that word many times. You probably heard it around campus here. Sharon, Silva, if you're watching, shalom. It's a common greeting in Israel when you're saying shalom, shalom, shalom. It's like saying good morning. But shalom means completeness. It means wholeness. If you've ever been in a Travis class, it means the settling of accounts. It's like things are the way that they should be. And he uses this because of all these false prophets that he is countering. It says in verse 8, you can read through it, but all these false prophets are preaching shalom, shalom, everything is going to be fine, you don't need to worry, there's no Nebuchadnezzar, nothing that's going to be coming up on us, no suffering. And Jeremiah is trying to say otherwise, saying, no, Nebuchadnezzar is coming. We need to prepare, 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 build houses, plant gardens, and make the most out of the time that you are in, that you are placed in, not expecting things to go back to the way that they used to. And the principle here is, in that last part of that verse 7, pray to the Lord on its behalf, for when it's shalom, you shalom. We could kind of informalize it like this. Shalom out, shalom in. Shalom out, shalom in. I work for the shalom of the circumstance that I'm in, regardless of what I'm feeling, regardless of if it's a favorable circumstance or not. Shalom out. I work towards the shalom so that I myself can experience shalom. I don't wait for shalom to happen. I make it happen. I don't wait for things to happen in my life. I just make it happen. I don't wait for shalom. I create shalom. I mean, we struggle with this when it comes to assignments and deadlines. And we try to muster up all of this motivation to try to get things done. But we end up doing things last minute because we don't get the motivation that we're looking for. And one thing that I found is motivation doesn't get stuff done. You get stuff done. I get stuff done. And one person that did this very well is Daniel. Daniel was one of the officials that were actually exiled under Jehoiakim. And he probably read this letter and followed through. How do I know? He, without an inch of compromise, he was able to be promoted to the highest places of every king that he served. And I read his story, it's amazing. But I want us to focus on one person. One person in the story of scripture that this points to. And that's Jesus of Nazareth. He was exiled. He experienced the ultimate exile. I mean, he was exiled to humanity. Being in the form of humanity, bringing himself down, associating himself with us, that is exile. 30 years in Nazareth working with his dad as a carpenter, preparing himself for ministry. That is exile. I was there. It's not a fabulous place, at least a replica of Nazareth. He was exiled to his own stubborn people, his own people, the Jews, who wouldn't listen to him when he said, I am the Messiah. I am the anointed one. I am the one the prophets point to. I'm who you're looking for. They wouldn't listen. And last but not least, the height of his exile was the cross. When Jesus absorbed the total sin of humanity on the cross, the Father could not look at him because he was so defiled by our sin, the total sin of humanity. And when he breathed his last breath, he let his spirit go. Travis says it like this: the Trinity was ripped open so that it can let you in. It says in Hebrews 13, verse 11, for the bodies of the animals whose blood is brought into the most holy place by the high priest as a sin offering are burned outside of the camp. Therefore, Jesus also suffered outside of the gate so that he might sanctify the people by his own blood. Therefore, let us go to him outside of the camp. Let's suffer with him. Let's identify with him, bearing his disgrace. In our seasons of exile, we can identify and get closer to Jesus because he experienced the ultimate exile. I want to go back and finish in the last, the everyone's favorite verse, verse 11 in chapter 29. For I know the plans I have for you. This is the Lord's declaration. Plans for your shalom, not disaster, to give you a hope and a future. The way God defines shalom is different than how we would define shalom. And this hope and future that Jeremiah is promising them is, keep reading. You will call to me and come and pray to me and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all of your heart. To this day, Orthodox Jews are still looking for a Messiah. They're still looking for the temple. They're still looking for some sort of presence of God, encounter. But we have it. We have who Jeremiah calls the Prince of Shalom. We have Jesus. We have our future and our hope secured in that God has chosen to dwell with us in his Son. And if you have Jesus in your life, you have a hope regardless of what circumstance you may be going through. I feel for those who are only hoping that they would survive the next day because of COVID-19. That's their only hope. When they don't have Jesus, that's all people hope for, is that they would survive the next day. But we have a hope regardless of if we're living or we suffer through this. We have a hope. We have a future secured in Jesus. And so we can identify with him. Hebrews 4 says he hasn't gone through anything that we haven't gone through. Or the other way around. He has gone through everything that we have. And so he can sympathize with us and we can go to him and find grace and mercy in time of need. And so he's gracing us right now. And I even encourage you, he's gracing you to find creative ways to find the shalom in your circumstance. And new disciplines are being formed in your life right now. God is giving you the grace for that. So I encourage you to make all the effort to participate with your church, participate with all of their efforts, get lectures done, get homework done, finish this semester strong. Shalom, find it in your life so that you yourself will experience shalom when you meet with Jesus and when he meets with you and you identify with him more and more and more, and he brings you his sweet presence. So I hope you have a shalom day, and I hope we can get to see each other again real soon. I love you. Shalom.